If you have your Bible this morning, turn with me to Acts chapter 13. Acts chapter 13, we're going to read beginning in verse 51 and read down through verse 7 of chapter 14. Acts chapter 13 and verse 51. And I want us this morning to see that we, as the people of God, by His Spirit, have been empowered with confidence. And we'll see where our confidence should lie and what it should compel us to do. So Acts chapter 13, beginning in verse 51, and reading down through verse 7 of chapter 14. And if you're able and willing to stand, would you please stand in honor of the public reading of God's Word. And this is what the Word of the Lord says. But they shook off the dust from their feet against them and went to Iconium. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. Now at Iconium they entered together into the Jewish synagogue and spoke in such a way that a great number of both Jews and Greeks believed. But the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their minds against the brothers. So they remained for a long time, speaking boldly for the Lord, who bore witness to the word of His grace, granting signs and wonders to be done by their hands. But the people of the city were divided. Some sided with the Jews and some with the apostles. And when an attempt was made by both Gentiles and Jews with their rulers to mistreat them and to stone them, they learned of it and fled to Lystra and Derbe, cities of Laconia, and to the surrounding country. And there they continued to preach the gospel. Father, I pray today that You would show us that we have been empowered with confidence. Confidence in the gospel and confidence in the God of the gospel. May we be like Paul and Barnabas, committed wherever we are to proclaim the good news that Jesus Christ is Savior and Lord in spite of whatever may come. We ask it in His name and for His sake. Amen. You may be seated. Confidence is that quality that empowers us to do things that maybe we would not ordinarily do, to carry on in the face of adversity, to stand up amid oppression, to overcome our fears and carry on with the challenges that lay before us. Julie Andrews sang about confidence, if you remember, in that classic movie, The Sound of Music. She said, I have confidence in sunshine, I have confidence in rain, I have confidence that spring will come again, despite what you see, I have confidence in me. Confidence is not in ourselves in the Christian life, though maybe sometimes the American dream spills over into our devotion to Christ, and we think that is where our confidence should come from. My granny was a Tupperware lady. She sold Tupperware all over Northwest Florida and South Alabama, and she was awfully good at it. But it was not her natural proclivity to just walk up to a stranger and invite them to host a party in their home. So early in her days of selling Tupperware, her manager gave her a little phrase. He said, Mary, when you go up to a door, you just say, man, I'm good. And so she said, I took that to heart, and I would go up to a house, and I'd go friend finding, and I'd try to get them to host a party, and I would be nervous and shaking, and I'd walk up to the door, and I just wouldn't even know how to overcome. And then I'd remember that phrase, and I'd say, man, I'm good. And I'd knock on that door, and I'd find a friend. And the next thing I know, I was selling them Tupperware. Sometimes we think it has to be that way with the gospel. That we have to look within, within our own strength of personality, within our own abilities naturally, within who we are as people, to be able to share the gospel, to stand up in face of adversity, to overcome the trials of life. And when we think that it is inside of ourselves that our confidence lies, we will find ourselves coming up short. We'll compare ourselves to other people around us. And we'll wonder, why are they able to endure the test? Why are they able to stand up amid trial? Why are they able to carry on when I'm looking within myself? I'm trying to find confidence. and I come up short. I want you to understand, brothers and sisters, that our confidence as Christian people does not come from within. It's not a matter of our own personality, our own ability. It's not a matter of the strength of our person, but of the God that we worship. We have confidence in God, and we have confidence in His gospel because the Spirit is at work in us. As we've gone through the book of Acts, we have seen the gospel going forward. Remember that that is what Jesus commissioned His disciples to do. In Acts chapter 1, in verse 8, Jesus said to His disciples who were wondering if at that time He would restore the kingdom to Israel, He said, "You will receive the Holy Spirit not many days from now. When you do, power is going to come upon you, and you'll be My witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth." Jesus saw His kingdom coming to bear upon the world through the ministry of His disciples. His disciples who bore His gospel. His disciples who proclaimed His name. His disciples who engaged a lost and dying world in the matter of discipleship to win lost men and women and boys and girls to Jesus. And so His disciples began that work. They were empowered by the Holy Spirit, and they began to bear witness. And in the earliest days of God's people bearing witness to His gospel, many people were becoming saved, but predominantly among the Jews. And so there came a time when God gave a vision to His servant Peter, a vision that said that he is no distinguisher of persons. He doesn't prefer one group over another. And Peter came to understand that Jews were just as likely to come into the kingdom of God and just as welcomed as Gentiles were. That has important bearing on the rest of the story of the book of Acts, because from Acts chapter 10, there begins to be a turn in which more and more the church, the disciples of Jesus, are engaging not only the Jews, but also the Gentiles with the gospel. You may wonder, well, what's the big deal? What are the distinctions between these two groups? Well, let's recall that the Jews are the descendants of Abraham. Abraham called by God, chosen to be His instrument in the world. Abraham, who is the father of this incredible nation to which God gave a promise that they would live in a great place, the nation of Israel, the land of Canaan, a promise that they would be a great people, as many as the stars in the sky or the sands of the sea, and a promise that they should be a light to the nations of the earth. And so all throughout the story of human history, God has worked through the life of His people Israel to bring about redemption for the nations. And that plan of redemption, of salvation, culminates in the great sending of the Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus, who lived a perfect life, who died a substitute death, who was laid in a borrowed tomb and raised on the third day, who ascended to power and glory and reigns at the right hand of God the Father, and one day is coming back for His own. And Jesus, the Savior of the world, the light of the world, commissioned His disciples to go and make other disciples of all nations. And so from the Jews who brought about the birth of the Messiah, God takes a redemptive story that is to the Jews first and gives it to the whole world. And because of that, we who are Gentiles, not ethnic descendants of Abraham, are grafted into God's family by faith. And that's what came to bear in the book of Acts as the children of God begin to preach the gospel, not to the Jews only, but also to the Gentiles. And in Acts chapter 13, the first three verses that we looked at last week, we saw that we have been empowered to go with the gospel. So what happened is that God came down and spoke by His Spirit to the church gathered at Antioch. A group of elders, prophets, teachers in the church were praying together, worshiping together. They were fasting together, and God spoke by His Spirit and said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul, whom I have appointed to do a special work." And so they commissioned Barnabas and Saul to go and be apostles, that is to be missionaries, people who were sent out with the gospel. Barnabas and Saul first make their way to the island of Cyprus, and they work there in Barnabas's homeland. And then they travel from the island of Cyprus back to Asia Minor, and they begin to work in cities like Antioch and Pisidia. Only there comes a rejection of Barnabas and Saul. They go to the synagogue, just as becomes Paul's pattern throughout his ministry. They preach the gospel to the Jews, and immediately they are met with favor. There's an embrace of this gospel, and the people are crying out to them, won't you come back on the next Sabbath and preach to us again? They do. An incredible crowd is drawn in Acts chapter 13. The people are eager to hear the preaching of Barnabas and Saul. Only this time, the Jews who are in leadership are jealous of the crowd that they are able to draw. And they begin to speak against them. They revile Barnabas and Saul. They stir up the people against them so that they feel compelled. They must leave Antioch and Pisidia, but they make their way onward. And they wind up in a town called Iconium, still in Asia Minor. And as they're going, Luke notes in verse 51 that they are filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. Though they have faced persecution, though they face rejection, though they have faced personal harm on account of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, they are not undone. Why? Because in the power of the Spirit, they have confidence to carry on. And that confidence comes to bear in Acts chapter 14 as they minister in a very similar way in the city of Iconium. You see there in Acts chapter 14 in verse 1, Luke says this, "Now at Iconium they entered together in the Jewish synagogue and spoke in such a way that a great number of both Jews and Greeks believed." There was a work that came out of Paul and Barnabas' experience that compelled them not to give up, not to give out, not to give way, but to go on with the gospel of Jesus Christ. They have faced difficulty. They've faced opposition. They've been attacked personally, and yet they continue to preach the gospel. Now, can we just be honest with each other? That in our lives, sometimes we go through difficult situations. Sometimes we go through difficulty. If you've been with us on Sunday night, then you've heard me say this. Sometimes we go through difficulty because we're sinful people and we bring things on ourselves. Sometimes we just have to admit that the difficulties that we face in life are the consequences of our actions. Sometimes we go through difficulty because we live in a broken world and life happens. Tires blow out. Credit cards get their information stolen. We wind up in hospitals with illness. Sometimes life just happens because we live in a broken world. And sometimes we go through difficulty because God Almighty has decided to refine us in His fire. And so He allows us to endure trial and testing in order that we should be proven faithful. And sometimes that comes on account of our stand for Jesus. In fact, I would submit to you that in the world in which we live, the gospel that we preach is increasingly hostile to the culture around us. If we are faithful to Jesus, if we are holding fast to the orthodox faith handed down from generations past, if we're going to stand where the Bible stands, then we will increasingly be found to be on the wrong side of the culture around us. That doesn't mean that we have to be hard-nosed about things. It doesn't mean that we have to force our faith down someone's throat. It doesn't mean that we have to intentionally egg on the opposition of society. But if we just stand where the Bible stands, if we live a life faithful to Christ, if we seek to be salt and light in the world of darkness and decay, then we will be found to be on the wrong side of the culture. And there are some in the culture who will seek to oppose us virulently because we stand with Jesus. You need to understand this. Because as a church, we are going to be talking more and more in days to come about how we can engage the world in discipleship. And so we need to understand from the beginning that the more we engage the world in discipleship for Jesus' sake, the more that we will face opposition on account of our faith. And some of us, facing opposition, facing trial, facing difficulty, will want to throw up our hands and walk away. I want you to see from the example of Paul and Barnabas that walking away is not an option. Instead, what we are called to do is not to look within, to our own personality, to our own ability, but to look up to God and into the truth of His Word and see that by His Spirit we have been given confidence to carry on. Paul and Barnabas first show us that we have confidence in the gospel. It says that at Iconium they entered together into the synagogue and spoke in such a way that a great number of both Jews and Greeks believed. But the unbelieving Jews stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their minds against the brothers. So they remained for a long time, speaking boldly for the Lord, who bore witness to the word of His grace, granting signs and wonders to be done by their hands. We have confidence in the gospel. Paul and Barnabas go to Iconium. They have faced difficulty on account of their faith, on account of their preaching, and they've had to leave one city and flee to the next, but they get to Iconium and they set about their standard practice. Where do they go first? They go to the synagogue, the place where the Jews meet. Why would they go there first? Well, first, because the gospel is to the Jews first. These are the people who have brought about the birth of the Messiah, the Savior of the world. And so we come to understand that the gospel is first to the Jews. But it's more than that. What we seem to see as the pattern of Paul is that he goes to the religious center, to the place where the most people would understand his preaching, and he preaches to them first, and then the gospel begins to disseminate. It works its way out. Paul goes to the Jewish synagogue, and when the time comes that they ask for any kind of response, for some word, Paul stands up and he gives a defense of the faith. He preaches the gospel. The gospel takes root. There are many people, Jews and Greeks, who are coming to faith in the Lord Jesus there in Iconium. Because of that, verse 2, you see that the Jews, they don't want this. They rise up against, they stir up the Gentiles and poison the minds of the brothers. That is to say that they begin a campaign against Paul and Barnabas. I hope you understand this, that in your life in Christ, from time to time, you're going to face opposition. And a part of opposition from the world, from the God of this world, from the devil, a part of opposition is not just to attack the gospel, but to attack those who stand for the gospel. You and I will face difficulty personally on account of our stand for Jesus. This attack was not just on the gospel that Paul and Barnabas preached, it was upon them themselves. And yet, in spite of the fact that the Jews stirred up strife, they stirred up resentment, they stirred up a campaign against Paul and Barnabas, you see in verse 3 that they were not undone. Instead, they remained for a long time, speaking boldly for the Lord, who bore witness to the word of His grace, granting signs and wonders to be done by their hands. Now, I just tell you, I'm not inclined to stay among a bunch of people who have it out for me. I would imagine most of us aren't. If we were to gather in a group and all of a sudden the tables turned and everyone was standing and reviling us and seeking our death, seeking to bring an end to our lives, seeking to destroy our reputation, we probably would not be inclined to just sit around and take it. And yet, what we see is that Paul and Barnabas, in the face of opposition, in the face of oppression, in the face of religious persecution, are not undone and they do not give way, but instead they continue to preach, speaking boldly for the Lord. Why? Because they have confidence in the gospel. Paul and Barnabas have come to understand two things. First of all, they've come to understand that the gospel is for everyone. They have personally experienced difficulty in preaching the gospel, but God has used that difficulty to expand their minds and open their eyes to this truth that the gospel is for everyone. If you look at Acts chapter 13 and you see Paul's preaching in Antioch at Pisidia, what Paul comes to see is that the Jews are unwilling to embrace the gospel, but Paul says, so be it. God is opening this as a door to the nations, to the Gentiles. He quotes from Isaiah 46 and 9, and he says, this is what happens, that God is making us a light to the nations. And because Paul and Barnabas understand that the gospel is for everyone, they believe that the gospel can save anyone. It's not just that they're to preach to everyone, but it is that in their preaching, they are seeking the salvation of souls, the salvation of Jews and the salvation of Gentiles, the salvation of men and the salvation of women, the salvation of Jews and the salvation of Greeks, the salvation of slave and the salvation of free. Paul and Barnabas have come to understand that the gospel is for everyone and the gospel will save anyone who believes. And because of that, when they face opposition, when they face persecution, when they go through hardship, they are not undone and they are not caused to give way. They do not cease, but more boldly in the power of the Spirit, they go on preaching. See, the Spirit does something in the lives of Barnabas and Saul. The Spirit empowers them to have confidence so that they preach the gospel they believe and believe the gospel that they preach. It's easy, y'all, to preach to saints on Sunday. Now, it's a hard task. I mean, I don't just whip these sermons out, but in the grand scheme of things, to stand before a room of people who love the Lord Jesus, who love His church, and who love the gospel, it is relatively easy to preach. But when we stand before people who are opposed to the Lord Jesus, who are opposed to the gospel, who don't want to hear gospel preaching, it becomes increasingly hard. And it is in the face of opposition that we will prove that we believe what we preach. This is not just a gospel that we talk about on Sunday. It's not just a set of beliefs that we give our assent to. This is not just an emotional reaction we have to a set of truths. Instead, the Holy Spirit gives us confidence so that we believe the gospel we preach and preach the gospel we believe. This has become personal for Barnabas and Saul. Why are they not undone in the face of opposition? Why do the trials and tests not push them away from this task that God has given them? Because the gospel is not something that they simply pay lip service to. The gospel is something that they believe to the core of who they are. They know that it's for everyone, and they know it will save. Because of that, they go on with the gospel, preaching boldly for the Lord. And do you see what the Lord does? They preach, this is verse 3, they speak boldly for the Lord, and the Lord honors their faithfulness. It says there in verse 3, they spoke boldly for the Lord, who bore witness to the word of His grace, granting signs and wonders by their We've maybe talked about this before, but if you've never caught this, this is an important truth. In the New Testament, when we see signs and wonders being done, miraculous events, the primary reason that those things are done is not to minister healing or provision to the person who receives the miracle. The primary reason that miracles and signs and wonders are wrought in the New Testament by the Lord Jesus or by his apostles is to bear witness to the veracity of their claims. When the Lord Jesus goes into the wilderness and takes a few loaves and a few fish and blesses them and feeds 4,000 people and has leftovers to boot, it is not just so that hungry stomachs are filled. It is to point to the reality that he is the sustainer of all human life. When the Lord Jesus rises from the dead, it is not simply to overwhelm everyone around with the reality that this is an incredible man, a wonder maker. It is to prove that he has power over death. And when his apostles are empowered by the Spirit to do signs and wonders, it is not simply to give grace and healing and ministry to those who receive these things, but instead it is to back up their claims that what they preach is true. The Lord blesses Paul and Barnabas and allows them to do signs and wonders. Not so that people will walk away talking about Paul and Barnabas, saying what amazing men they are, wanting to form a cult of personality around them, but so that everyone walks away knowing exactly what Paul and Barnabas know, and that is that the gospel can be trusted and the gospel must be preached. They have confidence in the gospel. So I want to ask you this morning, do you have confidence in the gospel? Maybe the reason that you struggle to share the gospel in the world with your friends or your family members or your coworkers is because you lack confidence. Now, I'll be honest with you. It's not a part of my personality to want to just go up to perfect strangers and talk to them about the gospel. In fact, can I let you in on a little secret? It's not a part of my personality to walk up to a perfect stranger and talk to them about anything. I can stand before you every Sunday and preach all day long till the cows come home, and it doesn't bother me at all. But you get me one-on-one with a person I don't know, and I clam up naturally. Most preachers are this way, if you didn't know. And yet, when I go and share the gospel with people who are lost, when I go and knock on a door and engage someone who I have no relationship with, when the Lord impresses upon my heart in a public place to talk to someone who I think probably wants to be left alone just like I do naturally, my interaction with them, my talking to them, my engaging them with the gospel is nothing to do with my confidence in myself, but with the confidence that the Spirit has given me that the gospel can save them like the gospel saved me. I look back to my life and I remember what God did for me. How God took the truth of his son's death, burial, and resurrection and applied it to me. Though I'd heard it thousands of times before, there came a day in my life when I knew that though it was for the rest of the world, it was really for me. I look back on that reality, and I am encouraged to keep sharing the gospel, because what God did for me, he would do for anyone. Do you have that kind of confidence in the gospel? As you seek to engage a lost world, are you trying to win them with all the elements that our culture says are important to reach unreached people? Do you have confidence in a certain style of music? Have you put your confidence in a certain way of dress? Is your confidence in a certain tactic of evangelism? Do you really believe that if we just had a certain way of worshiping together, a certain way of doing church, that we would reach more people? Or body of believers, is your confidence in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you stake your life on the good news that He died and rose again to save sinners from their sins? And is all of your life engaging the world around you with the truth of this gospel because you believe that where nothing else will, the gospel will save? Do you have confidence in the gospel? They had confidence in the gospel, but it was more than that. They had confidence in the God of the gospel. Look at verse 4. Luke tells us the people of the city were divided. Some sided with the Jews and some with the apostles. When an attempt was made by both Gentiles and Jews with their rulers to mistreat them and to stone them, they learned of it and fled to Lystra and Derbe, cities of Laconia, and to the surrounding country. And there they continued to preach the gospel. It's bad enough when people talk about you. Far worse when the talk leads to action. That's what happens here. As Paul and Barnabas are ministering in Iconia, they begin to experience pushback. There is a rejection by the Jews in the city. They are poisoning the minds of people so that they will look unfavorably on Paul and Barnabas. It's a personal attack. The poisoning of the mind, this in the Greek, means that not only are they speaking negative things about Paul and Barnabas, but they are moving people to action against Paul and Barnabas. So that what happens as they begin to stir up strife and rebellion and rejection, it leads to a move to physically harm them. In the middle of all of this, Paul and Barnabas demonstrate that their confidence is in the God of the gospel. I want to point out two things to you this morning. First of all, they have confidence that God can protect their witness. They have confidence that God can protect their witness. Unfortunately, we live in a broken world, marred by sin. And from time to time, the enemy rears his head in such a way that good and God-fearing people have their personal reputations attacked. And in those seasons, sometimes what we want in our human nature is to have those people rise up and defend themselves. We want to see people stand up and proclaim the truth. We want to see people present evidence that proves their innocence. We want to see people plead their cause. Maybe you've been in a situation like this. Maybe you found yourself on the wrong side of someone who wasn't walking with the Lord and they attacked your reputation. They called into question your character. They pushed against who you are and spoke ill of you. And maybe you've wondered and struggled with how to deal with that. Maybe you've struggled with how to respond. Can I just tell you that I believe that how we are called to respond is to just keep preaching truth. Having been on the wrong side of some people who didn't love the Lord Jesus and who spoke ill of me, there have certainly been occasions where I've wanted to plead my own cause. But what I've come to understand in my short years of ministry is that sometimes when you are dealing with the opposition that the enemy wants to throw at you, there's no way to defend yourself, and you have to let your reputation speak for itself and keep following the Lord. They poisoned the minds of those in Iconium against Paul and Barnabas, so much so that these people were willing to bring physical violence against Paul and Barnabas, willing to stone them to death. And yet that does not cause Paul and Barnabas to use their platform to plead their own cause, to promote their innocence, to fight for their reputation, to try to absolve themselves from sin, or to clean up their witness. Instead, they go on proclaiming the gospel, confident that God can preserve their witness. They care more about the gospel going forward than they do about themselves. And so their confidence is in God. God will take care of us. God will provide for us. God will fight our cause. How many of us need to learn this lesson and to be reminded of the truth of our Savior, who, like a lamb led to slaughter, opened not his mouth? It was not in the character of our Lord Jesus to defend himself, but to submit himself to the eternal plan of the Father and to trust that the Father would always do what's right. Paul and Barnabas follow in his footsteps. And we are called to follow them, to trust in the God of the gospel who will preserve our witness in spite of whatever opposition may come. Not only do they have confidence in the God of the gospel to preserve their witness, but also they have confidence in the God of the gospel to use them in their storms. Some of us believe that God can use us because of our storms. We believe that as we go through hardship, go through struggle, go through trial, endure persecution, that God can bring us through, and on the other side we'll be able to stand back and say, this is what the Lord did, and we see God using that. But I want you to understand that God doesn't just use Paul and Barnabas because of their storms or after their storms. He uses them in the middle of their storm. After all, they've been in the middle of a storm since they were at Antioch in Pisidia. They faced opposition there and so made their way to Iconium. They will face difficulty at Iconium, and so they make their way on to Laconia. They are on the run from society. They're on the wrong side of the culture. Everyone is positioning themselves against them. Those in the leadership, those of who are leaders among the Jews, are seeking to bring an end to Paul and Barnabas. And yet, God is using them in the middle of their storm to keep advancing the gospel. Do you have confidence that God can use you in the middle of your storm to advance his gospel? I mean, right where you are today, whatever difficulty you're going through. Maybe you find yourself in the middle of a health crisis and you're just not knowing how to carry on, but God can use you. He can use you to minister to doctors and nurses. He can use you to minister to other patients. He can use you as a family member sitting in a waiting room to minister to other families sitting in waiting rooms and pointing people back to the wonder of God's sustaining grace. God can take your need financially, where you're seeking him for provision. And even though you may not be seeing an end to the struggle, you may not know how things are going to work out, you may not have an understanding of how it's all going to be put together as you are in the middle of your financial storm, but you're leaning upon him, trusting him to provide. You are demonstrating and proclaiming to the world around you that just as Jesus fed hungry people in the middle of a desert, so he will take care of you. He is your provider. Maybe you find yourself in the middle of a broken relationship. Someone in your family or someone in your circle of friends or maybe even a coworker. And you're pleading for the words of Isaiah 58 and 12 to be true, that God would be a repairer of the streets and a restorer of the repairer of the breach and a restorer of the streets in which to dwell. You're pleading that that would be true in your life, that God would put things back together and build a relationship. But right now things seem broken. You can demonstrate that your confidence is in God to use you in the middle of your storm by continuing to cry out for Him and to offer grace to the person with whom you have broken fellowship. And if you find yourself here today in the middle of a spiritual storm, you think you're far from God, it's been a long time since you've heard His voice, it's been a long time since His word seemed to speak to you, it's been a long time since you thought that your prayers got any higher than the ceiling above you, if you find yourself wandering in a wilderness, longing for the Spirit of God to speak, you will demonstrate that your confidence is in God to use you in your storm by continuing to knock on the door of heaven until He opens up and speaks. Do you have confidence in the God of the gospel? If you don't this day, it may be because you have no relationship with Him. And if that's the case, then it's my urgent pleading that you would believe the truth of the gospel. That you would see what many of us have already come to see, that what Jesus did upon His cross in dying in the place of sinners, in taking our punishment and putting it upon Himself, was for you. That all of your sins, all of your transgressions, all the things you've ever done that were wrong in the sight of holy God, that they don't have to be laid against you. You don't have to pay the debt for your sin. In fact, you can't, but Jesus paid the debt for you. And when He rose from the dead on the third day, He did so to offer you eternal life. And if today you say, I don't have any confidence, my friend, the starting place is to put your faith in the God of the gospel.